I'm Jonathan Agnew. Welcome to the TMS podcast, looking back on the second day of the deciding England versus West Indies test from Emirates Old Trafford. To come, we'll get the thoughts of Carlos Brathwaite and Michael Vaughan, and we'll get reaction from Stuart Broad and Kemar Roach. Plus, we'll play you the Agger's aria from the full Tosca, TMS the Opera.
This is the TMS podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Well, bad light has stopped playing. We'll begin our review of the third day of this third and final test match between England and West Indies at Emirates Old Trafford. It closes on West Indies in their first innings on 137 for six. The captain, Jason Holder, 24 not out, and Shane Durich is on 10 not out. It means they're 232 runs behind England, and so as everyone will work out, that means they need 33 more runs to avoid the question or the possibility of being asked to follow on by England, who lost 6 for 111 this morning. They were bowled out for 369. They lost 4 for 22. And then there's a stand of 76 between Broad and Best. Broad went out to smash the ball all over the place. He hit the third fastest half century by an Englishman. His 50 came off 33 balls, and he was finally caught. It was a horrible dismissal, really, because he just, I think, premeditated a slog sweep. He got an absolute pie from Chase, a low full toss that he hit straight down deep mid-wicket's throat. But he made a very good 62, and in the light of what had happened before that, Pope out without adding to his overnight score of 91, and he was dropped before he was bowled by Gabriel as well. Butler made 56, Wokes made 1, Archer made 3, and Anderson was the last man out for 11 with Don Best on 18 not out. The best of the bowlers, Kemar Roach, took 4 for 72. But again, another very wholehearted display by Shannon Gabriel, who has kept running in and kept running in and kept running in. So that was what happened this morning. 369 all out, and West Indies have finished on 137 for 6. I think it was into the third day. It's actually the second day, isn't it, Michael?
Yes.
But there we go. It's a fascinating day. 12 wickets falling. I've been sort of saying around the place, I think England would be really disappointed about that morning, because that was a morning where they could really have nailed this game down. If they had scored another 100 runs, then that the whole follow-on issue might have looked, well, clearer, shall we say.
Yeah, but I think you've got to give the West Indies bowlers for that first hour. They were tremendous. Yep. Kemar Roach got movement, bowled the perfect length. They held a couple of chances. They've had two times in the test match. It was yesterday after tea where they had to win that hour, the West Indies, when England were 4 wickets down. They didn't win that hour. Allowed England to finish the day strongly. This morning they get 4 wickets, they're 280 for 8. And you think the West Indies have to win the next half hour. Blow England out for 290, 300. And they allowed Stuart Broad to come in and play with so much freedom. He played with risk, and it's hard to set fields because the ball's travelling to all parts. But when you only get 3 balls to hit the stumps, or would have gone on to hit the stumps from the seam bowlers, you know that you've just not got it right. Jimmy Anderson came out there, number 11. Spinners are on. They didn't even have a short leg or a silly point. And that was the moment I thought, wait a minute, you've just lost it a little bit here, Jason. And then once they got the bat in hand in these conditions, clouds around, the Duke ball, Jimmy Anderson, Stuart Broad, probably English cricket's test match best ever combination, you're not going to get too many. You're not going to get a huge score with the lack of experience in the West Indies batting lineup. And it just feels to me it's just a matter of time before the West Indies lose a wicket. Even when they have a small partnership and it develops, you always sense it's just a matter of time before something happens. And full credit to England, they kept coming and they keep bowling the right zone. Just after tea, when Anderson and Broad were together, I think there was 60-odd balls bowled and they scored 7.
Yes.
7 runs in 60-odd balls. And that's what they do. They're relentless. They don't give you much. And there comes a time where you think, well, you've got to take a gamble. You've almost got to try and force the momentum back onto them by gambling somewhat. But it's very, very difficult. It's almost impossible to get a huge, huge score against this kind of England attack in these conditions.
Yeah. Carlos has joined us, and we talked about that session after tea, didn't we? Obviously, there was a wicket fell. I mean, 3 fell in that session. Where do you think West Indies are at the moment? I mean, it was a rather meandering innings, wasn't it, really, generally? I think Holder obviously moved things along a bit towards the end.
Yeah, in this test, I'd say they've been upskilled. Ready ball, after tea. The attacking intent showed by Pope and Butler, they didn't have an answer to it. As long as they were able to regroup and come again on today's first session, they were good. As soon as Broad counter-attacked, again, they're a bit unsure of where to go. when you look at the batting unit, everyone is getting caught on the crease. Probably John Campbell was the only person getting a stride in. That was his eventual downfall, getting the short ball from Joffre and getting in a funny position. But Ross and Chase has been out LBW or bowled pretty much the same way in every single innings, bar the lifter from Joffre in the first test. Everyone is caught on the crease. They have their hands searching for the ball, and they need to find a way. I mean, it's probably too late now, but what I would say, the positive thing is the bowling unit would have learned from the second test. You saw increased number of bouncers and an actual plan B at certain points in the innings, and it's for the batsmen to learn as well. When the ball is swinging around, how do I get my weight forward and into the ball so that if I am hit on my pad like Ollie Pope was, at least I'm outside of off stump with majority of the batting milling off on off stump. When the short ball plan comes, how do I go about it? Do I duck for 11 overs? Do I fire some shots? How do I attack or be positive, whether in defence or in attack, against the short ball plan? So if the batting unit learns from this series the same way the bowling unit obviously have done from test match to test match, then I think this series would hold them in good stead going forward, but they have been outskilled in this test match.
Let's join Ellie Oldroyd, shall we? She's with Kimo Roach, I think.
Yes, absolutely. A man who joined very, very distinguished company today by getting 200 test wickets. Congratulations, Kimo.
Oh, thank you very much, man.
Yeah, what did it feel like? Did you have that milestone on your mind for the last few days?
Yeah, I guess a little bit too much. It was on my mind, some sleepless nights, you know, obviously looking back at my spells from before, obviously, to get some confidence going into these test matches. So it's a good feeling to get over that barrier now. It's obviously on to see how much more we can get for the West Indies, and hopefully 300 would be great.
When we talk about the likes of Ambrose, Walsh, Sobers, Holding, Roberts, who was your hero growing up?
Michael Marshall is definitely one of my heroes growing up. I didn't get a chance to really meet him, the great man, rest in peace. But obviously the videos I saw, the input and the advice I got from other people about him, like, he was a fantastic human being, obviously, and a fantastic bowler, so I'm trying to emulate him as much as I can.
Mm. How far do you want to carry on, and how many more wickets would you like to get?
I'll try for 300. I'll try for it. It's going to take a lot, but I think I have it in me to get 300 test wickets, so I'll work hard towards that, and let's see how far I can go after 300.
You had such a brilliant spell at the start of today with Shannon Gabriel, and then things maybe just went slightly weird with Stuart Broad out there. How did you assess today?
Basically? We started well, as you said, picking up four wickets pretty early was pretty good. But obviously Stuart Broad came in and he played his shots. Things went his way, played well as well. So yeah, things just drifted a little bit against us, but we still did well to bowl the team out. And obviously we're batting now, a little bit of a tough position, but I'm confident the guys will stick it out and obviously fight for this test match.
Yeah, there's a lot to fight for. Yeah. If you can retain the Wisden Trophy, then that would be a special way for you to finish this tour.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah. Well done, Kimo.
Thank you very much.
Lovely to talk to you. Thank you.
Cheers.
Kimo Roach, on to 300 he goes.
Yeah.
Which he might well do these days. A lovely bowler, and well done him on getting his 200. Let's talk about Stuart Broad, because when you've got a left-handed batsman who's got a great eye, which he does have, he's got a lot of shots. But when a left-hander in particular, it seems to me, gives himself a little bit of room, that whole offside is just opened up, isn't it? I mean, he can scythe it from almost first slip round a long off. It can just go all over the place. And it's dangerous. Dangerous when he connects like that.
Yeah, I mean, they just got it wrong. I mean, my belief, I mean, and when I was captain, I got it wrong a few times as well, because you're out there and the emotions and you're trying to bowl Yorkers and bouncers, and before you know it, he's got to 15-20. And then you try and get a couple in the right zone. He's in, he swings one over your top of your head, it goes for four, and then an edge goes for four, an inside edge goes for four, a top edge pull goes for four. So it's not easy. There's two things that they should have done. They should have kept it simple. Should have kept it very simple. Just aim for the furniture. Aim for the three sticks. Or they should have gone wide of off stump and just say, right, we'll go wide of off stump and really make him fetch the ball and pat the offside and make him do something different. But it's very difficult to stop the momentum when a player like that comes out and gets to 20 so quickly. I think he got to 20 in 10 balls. And almost you're trying to drag it back. And it's then, as a captain, you need some real senior players around you that just go up to you as a skipper and just say, Skip, I think we're getting this wrong. Can we just go back to the basics of the game? You know, he's hitting us to all parts. Let's just go and let him hit us to one side of the ground. But I've been in that kind of situation, and I can understand that you get a bit flustered and you kind of think he's just going to chip one straight in the air and you'll get him out eventually. Where it's there when you just need that little bit of calmness or someone next to you to say, look, let's get the basics right. And the West Indies didn't cover the basics well enough. And if they'd have bowled England out for 280, 290, you know, you go out to take your guard and it just looks so much different to the 360-odd that they had to take guard with. And, you know, it also gives Broad a huge amount of momentum to get the ball in hand. You know what it's like if you've got a few runs as a bowler, really, and you then bowl and you think, well, I've already contributed to the game situation. I've put our team in a strong position and now I've got the chance to bowl on the venue that I bowled so well on just a few days ago. Broad's been great. I mean, there's something in his mechanism that when he gets a bit of stick and a bit of criticism, it's happened before. You only have to go back a year or two ago. I can't remember when it was. I think I kind of prodded him with something and he came back, proved me wrong. Fine, great. He misses the first test. He does an interview, puts himself under pressure. It takes a mental kind of toughness in your own game and your own confidence to be able to then deliver. And it's the second week now that he's delivered. All right, he's playing a West Indies side that he would expect to deliver against. But it also takes a huge amount of mental strength to do it under the pressure that he put himself under.
Must be frustrating, Carlos, because the fast bowlers know he doesn't like the short stuff. So he set the fields, but actually one of the first bounces he got from Roach, actually, bang, he hit it for six. And suddenly you go, whoa, hang on a minute, perhaps he can do this. They didn't bowl many more after that, real proper sort of head-hunting bounces.
Yeah, when you look at the way he came up to bat, Roach probably won over left, had a long spell. Shannon Gabriel, same thing. Then you think Jason Holder not really going to threaten you with a bouncer. Roachy dug one in, which was good. I think Shannon dug one in as well, and it just missed him. But in that situation, as Vaughan said, you want someone to slow the game down. You want him to think about it. You want him to have to rely on his skill, his batting ability, which he obviously has. But the fear that he's had from the short ball overtakes the batting ability more often than not. He just went off emotion, he just went off adrenaline, and before you knew it, because of the lack of faith in the batting lineup, it all of a sudden turned to, we need to save runs. As soon as it crosses 300, then Jason Holder's always counting down, how much runs do I actually feel my batting lineup can get me? If you had a Virat Kohli, a Pujara, a Rahane, you'll say, yeah, go on, keep knocking it about, you probably get to 30 or 40 a little quicker, but you keep fielders in catching positions, you make more chances because you're sure that your batting lineup can repair the damage done by a short broad blitz. When you're not so sure, the first thing he has proven to do is to get defensive and go in a shell, and then you see everyone spread to all parts, and then as a result, Dawn Best got probably the easiest 18 anyone has ever scored in Test cricket. No threat, no catchers.
Hardly knew he was there, really, did we?
No. block, single, block,
but
single.
Carlos, that's probably why the explanation of Jason Holder bowling first. You know, it's very easy for him, you should have batted, but in his mind he's thinking, wait a minute, I've got a 300 team.
Yes.
So I need to bowl really England out for 200 like I did in the first test. And if there's any moisture, I'm worried with my batting that we could get bowled out for 120, 140 and that's game over. So you've got to look at it at two sides of the fence. It looks like it's an awful decision the second week on the trot. But from his perspective, with his team, he feels that the best way to win, if there's any moisture in the surface, which there wasn't as much as he probably thought, is to bowl England out for just over 200, his team get 300, and then do a similar thing to what happened in Southampton, knowing that he'd have to chase probably 200 in the last innings of the Test match. When you've got that kind of team and batting lineup, I understand what he's done. I do understand it, but you kind of look and think, oh, wouldn't it have been worth just to try a different method to what didn't work last week?
Yeah.
I think for him, Southampton is perfect. If West Indies are to move to number one in the world and be the best test team ever, they need that Southampton blueprint every test match they play. But you come to Manchester, you're faced with overcast conditions, then it gets hot. The pitch doesn't do as much as Southampton, not as much inconsistent bunks. You're then forced with passages of play, which you got to mix it up, have a plan B, have a plan C. You saw Stokes running in when West Indies got a bit of a partnership. Body laving on the trot, just short balls from around the wicket. West Indies don't have that, neither with the bowling at the moment or the batting to be able to counteract that. So when the game is just bat and ball down the channel, battle of patience, West Indies will win, because they've become a very patient side and they execute the basics on a longer basis in comparison to recent past. However, when they're taken out of their comfort zone and ask questions of the skill set, the mindset, the intensity, the intent, that's when they're found lacking. And in Manchester, these two test matches have thrown up so many plan B's, C's, D's. We've run through the whole alphabet.
Carlos, you can come back to Manchester. You actually described Manchester as hot.
Did he?
Yeah, he described it as hot.
Only once. Only once.
I heard he said it was hot.
Did he?
Yeah, you can come back, Carlos. Well,
tell me who's just before we've got a couple of minutes to go. Who missed out today? I think. It was Joss Butler.
Yeah,
there was a chance actually to put away a lot of the noise and just to, you know, well, he didn't have to necessarily get 100, but just to
I think a
big score.
44 Test matches for 100 for his ability. Yeah. He knows it's not what he would have expected. You know, all I'll say to him is that make sure that you keep that technique going forward, because his technique has been so much stronger this week, just so much able to get back towards the ball where it's come from with that foot opening up. Balance of being able to play a forward defence. Again, I keep saying it, but if you can play a forward defence at test match level, you can bat for a period of time. If you've got any kind of ounce of negativity or doubt that forward defence won't be played with balance, you're just not going to survive. There's always going to be a ball that just nips back onto the stumps and you're going to be back into the sheds quicker than you would have liked. So all I say is continue to play in that fashion. Whatever the kind of mental kind of state that he's been in this week, whatever the kind of triggers are in his own mind for that technique to work, write it down. Write it down now, this week, and bring it out against Pakistan. Because what he's done there in getting that score and having that strong partnership with Ollie Pope, is pretty guaranteed that he's going to play the full three test matches against Pakistan. I can't think that they're going to change. But just bring that technique week after week.
The TMS Podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Let's get some reaction now from the England camp then. Stuart Broad had another good day, this time with bat and ball, and he's been talking to Eleanor Oldroyd.
Well, Stuart, you've had quite a day with bat and with ball. How do you reflect on that?
Yeah, really good day. I mean, we set out this morning wanting to try and get 400, but actually, you know, I think the West Indies bowled beautifully this morning, asked us a lot of questions, so 400 would have been way above par, actually. But it also gave us some encouragement as a bowling unit, seeing how well they bowled and how much they got out the pitch, that if we could bring the West Indies batsmen forward and play with a straight bat, we'd be in the game. So I think we probably got just over par with the bat. Credit to how the guys went about it yesterday, Butler and Pope and Burns. And then, the way we bowled was exactly what we wanted to do. We wanted to apply pressure, control the rate, build momentum that way, and then when wickets come, the West Indies haven't gone anywhere. So it was a brilliant day in that respect, but we've got to go again tomorrow.
Let's talk about your batting. Ian Botham, Andrew Flintoff, Alan Lamb, Stuart Broad, England batsmen who've got 50s in 33 balls or less.
I know, yeah, it's quite fun that. I'm a bit annoyed I sort of slowed down at the end and started knocking ones. If I'd have known that, I might have kept going. But yeah, it was good. It was probably the right way to go. I think we saw how much movement that Shannon and Kumar were getting from nibbling the ball around the stump line. So I thought if I let them just continue doing that, I'm going to get out. So I wanted to try and strike the ball and put them off their lengths. And then once I got going, I sort of couldn't rein it back, really. So it was great fun. I thought Bessie was brilliant to bat with out there, almost showed brilliant experience for such a young guy to keep playing the way he did, and didn't let me sort of swiping away change the way he went about his business. So yeah, it was great fun. I have done some tactical work with Peter Moores in the lockdown period, well, after the lockdown period, in our training bit, and looked a lot at how sort of Shane Warne batted, and just scored in different areas and was awkward to bat to bowl to, particularly in that sort of 05 Ashes series. And that's something that I looked at and wanted to try and replicate. And, you know, it's hard in this biosecure environment. We don't get a lot of match time unless you're playing test matches, which is strange for us. Normally at this time of year, we'd have played 10 first-class games. So it's hard to really know how you're going in the net. So it was good to spend a bit of time out there.
Yeah, it was your first 50 since 2013, I think, wasn't it?
Seven. I scored one at the MCG when Cookie got to 30 odd, I think.
Right, well, there you go. You don't forget such things. But I was going to ask you if you'd done work on that. Have you done work psychologically as well as technically?
Not really. I think the tactical side of it is probably the most important, to realise where how you want to go about it, because for me, there's no point me trying to hang around for an hour and play a lot of defensive shots, because I think the bowlers, when it's doing as much as that, will be too good for me. So to try and put them off what they're doing and try and get in the West Indies bubble like that, it was probably a thing that would suit me, especially batting at number 10. But yeah, I really enjoyed it. I think I got a lot of confidence at the Wanderers, batting with Mark Wood, where we put on nearly 100 really quickly. And I think that sort of style really suits my striking technique, really. You know, I want to take the game away from the bowlers, and you know, it was perfect for that scenario.
And then you come out to bowl and you take a wicket in the first over. We talk about momentum. Did you gain confidence from scoring those runs?
Potentially, yeah. And last week I felt like I bowled really well, and I felt that end really suited me. So that might be a bit loud, that, but I was running into bowl almost feeling like I was in last week's game. So I wasn't finding my feet. I was just running in and getting going. And I think the way we built pressure, all of the bowlers today, was brilliant. It was brilliant opening the bowling with Jimmy again and sort of proving that the way we go about our business is successful in Test match cricket, and we'll just have to try and repeat that tomorrow morning.
It was lovely to see you bowling together. It was actually quite sweet watching you sharing a jumper as well.
Yeah,
that was your jumper, I think, wasn't
my
it?
My jumper. It sort of, I think, when you're bowling, obviously you don't need a jumper on because you're too warm. But when you have those six balls off, you do need a jumper to try and keep the back warm. So we decided to, I don't know why, but decided just to keep swapping jumpers to save the 12th men having to do 50-yard sprints every over.
Well, it was great, and it obviously worked. And confident that tomorrow you can go finish the job and set up the win in the series?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, our number one aim is to win this Test match and to take the series. But I think as a short-term goal, we should try and get these wickets to try and enforce the follow-on. That's got to be an aim for us in the morning. That'll keep us very focused and looking after the run rate, because we don't have too many runs to play with. But when you do that, you get wickets. So I think we want to be in the position where we could enforce a follow-on, and that means we'll have to bowl really well in the first hour.
Mm. And just a quick final one. You've now got more than twice the number of Test runs as your dad. Have you pointed that out to him?
I didn't know that, but it's a nice stat to have. But I won't say anything yet, because he's still match referee and I'm still under his control, so to speak. So I might mention it to him after the Test match when he can't find me.
Thanks, Stuart. Well done. Thank you.
Cheers.
You're listening to the TMS podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
Well, you may remember last summer we heard about two music teaching sisters, Anna and Sarah Wilby, who began to write Full Tosca, TMS the Opera, on Sarah's canal boat. We played the opening chorus last year, but the lockdown period has allowed them to finish the whole opera, and they've even managed to record some of it virtually. So we'll hear from Anna and Sarah in a moment, but first let's listen to the Aggers aria, Stalwart and True.
I am Aggers, stalwart and true, leader of this resolute crew. My heart is pure, my tongue is light, to commentate is my delight. So answer me this, why are we all here? This time of the year, good gracious, no, our blood is up. We're here to win the Cricket World Cup.
Welcome to Lords for the final match of the 2019 Cricket World Cup. England have snatched hope from the jaws of defeat to get this far, breaking their losing streak to beat India and then Australia in style.
Rests on one final test, New Zealand and the host. Come on, England!
Still on its way,
my army all here. Is it just habit this time of the year? Good gracious, no, our blood is up. We're to win the Cricket World Cup. We're to win the Cricket World Cup.
That's the first time I've heard that. Anna and Sarah, hello. Just remind us how this opera started. You're on your canal boat, weren't you?
We were, yeah. So I was actually on maternity leave and had a baby, and we were trying to go somewhere where we could all be together and safe. And on the way down, we had heard the last hour. I think you'd had rain, so you'd played it again, the World Cup. And we just thought it just sounded like an opera. It had such poetry to it, and motion, and heroism, and drama. So we thought, that's absolutely inspiring stuff. And with the chorus in the background, really, this audience were just singing their hearts out.
It sort of wrote
itself in many ways. So we had the mad idea, managed to get hold of some manuscript paper and jotted down a few bits and pieces. And actually, it's just gone from there. It's been really, really good fun. And so many people have got involved.
Well, that's what's really nice about it. So this is a full-length opera. I mean, how many have you heard the aria there that you very kindly dedicated to me, as it were. But how many other songs are there in there?
I think there's probably about 10 separate movements. The idea was to try and introduce all the characters of TMS as well, as have some chorus numbers, and trying to make it as jolly and fun as it all is for everybody, was a tap dance number, obviously, for the umpires. Kind of wrote itself, to be honest, as well.
Statistician's blues,
things like that. So, yeah, it's been really good fun. We've really enjoyed it. And obviously, with lockdown having happened, so many people desperate to get the cricket back going that we've kind of kept it going a little bit ourselves in our own little way.
So we've managed
to complete it. But it is an opera in one act, so no one gets a chance to leave halfway through.
Right, OK. Well, my next question, really, was, I mean, is there a story to this? Is there a narrative to this opera? Or is it just, some music that you've dedicated to various people who appear on TMS?
Well, it's all set around the final of the World Cup. So it starts with an overture which would have Jerusalem in it that the audience has to sing, and then it sets the scene, introduces the main TMS characters, and then concludes with a musical setting of the super overs from the finals.
Lovely. And Sweet Caroline, Neil Diamond, does he feature in there?
He does, but don't tell him.
He'd have to, because Lords was just absolutely ringing to that for that last hour in particular.
That's it.
Yeah. Oh, no, it's absolutely. So, how have you recorded this then? Because obviously, I heard a man's voice there singing that aria. How have you managed to get people to record this opera for you?
Well, it's the wonder of social media. So, we put out a post a few days ago saying, were there any Lords musicians around? And thankfully, yes, there were. The Agger's figure himself is Sarah's husband, Edward Allen, fabulous. And then the chorus.
He's got a lovely voice, by the way, far better than mine.
He's brilliant.
He'll be very proud.
He'll be very, very glad after the baby. But the rest are a lot of our friends who answered the call, and we sent out a backing track and the music, and they sent us their recordings, and we edited it all together.
Oh, and I see one of the songs called Boycott Nightmare, which rather caught my eye, and I'm quite pleased about that. You better tell us about that song and the actual what is Boycott Nightmare?
Well, we were faced with the problem that he wasn't actually at the World Cup, so there's a little bit of artistic license, but essentially he kind of is set with him in bed having a nightmare, and he's just sort of rambling away with all his main saying, stick of rhubarb, etc., etc., and
Excellent.
Lots of patriotic Yorkshire-ness. Yeah, very important.
Proper boycott bingo. You went through the whole card, did you?
We did, absolutely, yeah. That's right.
So, now, what are you going to do that? I mean, you've obviously recorded a lot of this virtually, but I mean, are you planning to actually perform it somewhere?
Absolutely. I mean, we're, you know, we're both music teachers, so we're in this great situation where kids have to do what we tell them. So we're going to put it on at school as soon as we're allowed, basically. And I think our vision is that the opera itself is about 30 minutes, so that it would be a way of bringing together lots of aspects of school life. So we'd actually start with a 2020 cricket match and then have tea and then everybody into the hall for the performance of the opera.
What a nice idea. That's fantastic. I mean, any thoughts of a sequel? I mean, I suppose the World Cup finals was a bit of a one-off, wasn't it?
Yeah, we'll put it on first.
Yeah, you never know.
The TMS Podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
I wonder when we'll see the first full performance of TMS, the opera. You can watch highlights of events here at Old Trafford on Today at the Test on the BBC iPlayer or via the website. And there's plenty more to enjoy on BBC Sounds, including some classic View from the Boundary interviews, such as this one from 1991 with Lawrence of Arabia star Peter O'Toole with Brian Johnston.
You didn't, at the start, appear to be sort of in an acting family or anything. How did you get into acting?
Oh, looking back on it now, there seems to be an inevitable logic to it all, but it wasn't. I really stumbled into it from one thing to another. Somebody got ill and I took it over in an amateur production, and then someone said, you ought to do it professionally. And I thought, well, shall I try this? And then I got a scholarship to the RADA and it went from there.
Yeah, and you got the scholarship by rather just barging in and making a nuisance of yourself, so I'm told. Well, so Kenneth Barnes heard you and...
You're very well informed.
Well, I know people at that RADA, and they say you were making so much noise, he came out and said, what's going on? And said, we'll give the chap a test, and having given you the test, he gave you a scholarship. Is that right? It's too good to be true.
It's not quite true, but what is true is that I'd spent the night in Stratford-on-Avon watching Michael Redgrave play King Lear. And looking for somewhere to sleep. I had no money. I slept in a field with a chum. And we'd covered ourselves with what we thought was straw. And it was indeed merely the cosy to a dung pile. And so when we'd thumbed our lift into London, we weren't exactly fragrant. But the lorry driver dropped us at Euston Station.
Pretty quickly, I should think.
Very quickly. And, well, it was... Even that was a bit terrifying. It was a lorry carrying beer barrels. And we were standing on the beer barrels, rattling around. Got off at Euston, aiming for a men's hostel where we had indeed had booked a bed. And I passed the RADA. And I thought,
Royal Academy of Dramatic Art, yes.
And I popped in, and I began a conversation with the sergeant, the commissionaire at the door, and we were looking at a bust of Bernard Shaw. And the sergeant and I were telling stories about Bernard Shaw. And Sir Kenneth Barnes did come along and joined in the storytelling. And I think one of my stories may have intrigued him or something.
I think you smelled him. Were you still ponging then?
Well, my companion said you would be removed from there, O'Toole, by a person with a clothes peg on his nose.
Lawrence of Arabia, one or two others turned the part down.
Did they
not? Weren't you told? They said Finney turned
it
down.
Very nice of them. I'm delighted that they did.
You snapped it up as soon as it was offered.
As soon as it came my way. I felt I was in the slips and the ball came my way. I thought I'd have that one.
Yeah. You were on a pretty sandy wicket, though, for a long time, weren't you?
Very. And Omar Sharif, another good cricketer.
Did you ever have any games in the desert?
In the middle of the desert, and 120 degrees, yes, we played cricket to the astonishment of the Bedouin, who hadn't the foggiest idea what was going on.
Did they feel for you?
No, they didn't, but they looked at the ball with great suspicion, and then one of them picked it up and thought, oh, this is a wonderful weapon, and they were flinging it at each other.
Well, did it take an awful long time to do? I mean, it was a long film.
It took a couple of years.
Did it? Out of your life?
In my life, it became my life. It was more than just a film. It was a huge adventure. I mean, it was everything that a young 28-year-old man could wish, or I could wish at least, to be out into the desert, into the Holy Land, to be working with a genius, David Lean, with a first-class script by Robert Bolt, with a company of superb actors.
Quite a few in the company, to say the least. Thousands.
I need a score sheet, or I'll leave somebody out. But it really was. Mm. And I was like a young... matador. Another bull would come in. I'd play with the who's this morning? Anthony Quinn. Who's today? Alec Guinness. Who's today? Anthony Quayle. Who's today? Donald Wolfert. Who's today? Claude Rains. Who's today? Arthur Kennedy. Who's today? Jose Ferrer. It was astonishing.
Not a bad 11, that.
Not a bad.
You can enjoy plenty of classic View from the Boundary interviews on BBC Sounds. We're back on air at 10:15 for our highlights half hour, and then from 10:45 also on Radio 4 Longwave.